Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are on this fast forward planet, which is an overheating planet. This coming week, we'll be discussing the latest and final big report from the sixth assessment in 30 years of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change process. Going to have some of the authors on Monday. When I started Sustain What, this Columbia webcast back in March 2020, the main focus was the pandemic. And we're circling back here again today with a very special guest, David France, filmmaker, journalist, author. And I see John Cohen is in the green room now coming in as well. And I believe Laurie Cohen was a classmate of mine at Columbia Journalism School, a great journalist. But Laurie Garrett will be here, who wrote the 1996 bestseller on the coming plague. So there's a continuity in the interests and concerns of everyone on this webcast today. It's great to be with you. We were all together in physical form just a few weeks ago, a couple weeks ago in New York City. John Cohen left his surfboard behind and came from San Diego and came east. John plays a very special role in the film called How to Survive a Pandemic. That is David's latest. A decade ago, David France created a film about the AIDS pandemic called How to Survive a Plague. We're going to show a little scene from the new film in a minute, which just opened on HBO Max a couple of days ago. If not yet, was it just yesterday or 2 days ago?
It was on Tuesday, a couple of days ago.
Congratulations. What an epic thing to have to try to chronicle, because of course it's a global phenomenon. We'll talk about the structure of the film, but I thought we'd start in a little bit, John, with just a little update on where the hell we are with this persistent little virus. And I'm showing an illustration that's one of my favorite visualizers of this pandemic is Phil Schellekens at the World Bank, who does this informally on his own. And this is a map of the unvaccinated world. The continents are distorted in the context of which ones have not yet seen multiple vaccines. And it's just a horrifying picture on several levels. One is just the gross inequity, which also comes across in the film. And the other is that's a landscape of opportunity for the virus. So John, just maybe a quick, what's on your notebook today? Where are we with this pestilence?
Well, when David wrapped up the film, there was still a major issue about providing enough vaccine to the world and reaching people in lower income countries. But things have changed. The supply now largely is meeting demand, and the demand has dropped. So there are many countries that say they cannot deliver the vaccines quickly enough. So the issues have shifted. There's still an under-vaccination of much of the world.
Right.
But it's not simply about supply any longer. That is kind of moved to the side. And right now, today, I just finished a draft of a story a few minutes ago that looks at all the new mRNA vaccines that are in clinical trials right now. There are, by my count, 17 of them. Wow. And that's pretty heartening. Given that Pfizer, BioNTech, and Moderna have what many consider to be the most effective vaccines in the short term, their durability clearly isn't what we want it to be. Much of the world hasn't had access to those mRNA vaccines. And so there's a lot of hope right now that mRNA vaccines will, in short order, prove safe and effective from other companies in developing countries. And I think that's a major shift.
What you just mentioned about the inability to deliver reminds me so much of, this is a weird jump, the clean energy issue, which I've just been writing a lot about. Everyone knows that heat pumps, for example, are super efficient. Switching an old house like mine to one of these electric heat pumps can save all kinds of things, money. But they've calculated we have to train 100,000 people a year just to have the capacity to roll that stuff out. The technology is there. So that gets to this issue with the virus. And I think, David, in the film, you get at this too. I'm going to show a clip, the trailer in a minute. But David, just given where we are right now, like if you start on part two, what's the key question you pursue? And then we'll get into the film itself.
You mean if I were to talk about a sequel?
Yeah.
I'm afraid I've had enough pandemic.
I'm sure you have.
Being, thank you. I could say the same about the whole world, that obviously it's still a problem and it's being still handled in this patchwork way, both in terms of, the proposals for how to avoid the spread and how to preempt these spikes as they come, and what to do with the vaccines and how to distribute them. John's right that there's now a bottleneck in Africa and elsewhere where they're saying, please don't ship us anymore. We can't. We suddenly have this massive supply coming in with no infrastructure in place for distributing it. I guess what I'd like to see is for somebody to not keep going forward on this, but to go back and find out where we went wrong and find ways to fix it. And I think the big answer to that would be to find ways to empower public health across borders that we discovered once again is not possible in this environment.
Yeah, this thing called public health is such an elusive concept still for many people. Kirk Smith, who was a famed Berkeley scientist, who was one of the early pioneers of measuring public health, looking at statistics for stroke and pollution and the like. And he said, doctors are the failure people. You go to your doctor because public health has failed. We need more of that focus on the foreground. John.
There's one thing I want to add that I think is really peculiar in this situation. We've never attempted to vaccinate this many people in this short order. And the massive vaccine programs that take place every year are geared for children. And so we're trying to do something. Adrian Hill in the movie says, we've never vaccinated more than 500 million people in a year.
That was an amazing statistic.
My latest count of produced product to date from Airfinity, a company that tracks this, is there have been 13 billion doses produced. And we delivered last year, 10 billion, 11 billion doses. It's astonishing what we're asking healthcare workers to do that they've never had to do. On top of, when you're a healthcare worker in an African country, you have so many burdens that you're already struggling with. So, I think we have to keep in mind that we're really asking something extraordinary out of the healthcare system that already is overstressed and underfunded and broken in the United States as well as in, many, many countries around.
Well, that's why I think we have to fix it, because this is not the first time we're going to do this.
No, absolutely. Yeah. I think Laurie has written a great deal about the failure of to maintain the public health system. Right. Public health systems used to be stronger in the United States. We've gone backward.
Right. So let me show the trailer for those who haven't seen it. Again, this is on HBO Max. It is streaming now.
Hold on. Bike around the world. The race to find a COVID-19 vaccine is gaining pace. The pandemic is burning out of control.
So I'll turn now to the director of the FDA's vaccine division.
My wife, she's teaching an art class upstairs, so hopefully you won't hear a lot. Our process must increase trust in vaccines. Without that, we're going to continue to work in places like my basement.
We've never created a new vaccine in less than 5 years.
We're going to defeat this with vaccine strategies that have never been used before.
We do have to face the possibility that it could be never.
We all have the same goal, get a safe and effective vaccine.
It's called Operation Warp Speed.
I'm walking a fine line, being the only one in that task force who's not afraid to tell the West Wing what they don't want to hear. There is something that's called reality.
One shot and we're getting antibody responses. This vaccine might actually work.
Hello, everybody.
Good news. We made it.
94% efficacy for the vaccine.
This is insane.
The revelation of science.
Overnight, a potential turning point.
Getting this vaccine out is going to be one of the biggest tasks we've ever undertaken.
New variants will emerge in areas of the world where vaccine coverage is much lower.
This is all part of our reality now.
If all you care about is yourself, if you want to go back to commerce, tourism, you will not be able to do that if the epidemic's raging in other countries.
Their perspective is, look, we want to help the world, but we need to protect our people first.
We're asking all countries to be part of a global effort to ensure some people are vaccinated in all countries, not all people in some countries.
This is a catastrophic moral failure.
We're in the race of our lives. Just give us the vaccines. What happens next is up to us.
And that's still true. What happens next is up to us. So David, just a brief bio sketch for those who haven't seen your work before. What got you focused in this arena, you know, of public health, of illness and injustice?
Well, it's really was not by design in any real way. I moved to New York in 1981 to study philosophy for my PhD. And to discover gay life in New York City. And I got to the city just a number of weeks before HIV got to the city, or at least the reports of HIV got to the city. And it soon became clear that everybody in the affected community had to take an assignment. You know, we were all called to arms. And and I couldn't do those things that other people did. I had no, you know, font of empathy to take on hospital visits and all those other things that people were doing. So I settled on journalism, which is not something I had studied, but I began my career as a person just trying to find information about HIV to report it out to the community. And I was not a person who had done well in academically in science. But I suddenly was in a panic for the capacity to understand the science. So I began as journalism career as an HIV AIDS reporter, which is something I've done pretty thoroughly through these last couple of decades. And it gave me a career in journalism. I started in filmmaking after the economic collapse of 2008, the Great Recession, shrunk feature wells in newspapers and magazines. So I started playing in documentary filmmaking, and I made How to Survive a Plague. Then I had been trying to find a publisher interested in allowing me to look back at those years, those plague years of AIDS, before the effective medications came out in 96. And all of publishing was impacted. So I began working in documentaries then, and I found it is a medium that is powerful. It's got crazy power, and I've enjoyed trying to harness that power.
So John, where were you in 1981? I just have to say that was the year I came to New York City to go to the Graduate School of Journalism at Columbia. And one of the first stories I wrote as a student was on GRID, gay-related immune deficiency, down at NYU. I remember going to the hospital there, and you know, the doctors would be befuddled. So similar trajectory, although I got hijacked by climate and earthquakes and other kinds of risks. I'm glad you stuck with this. John, 81.
81, I had just completed my degree here in San Diego at UCSD in science writing. I was going to apply to medical school, and in my junior year had decided I didn't really want to be a doctor, and I had completed everything to go to medical school, and I had the grades, so my Jewish mother was happy, and I realized I was doing it for her, not for me, and I was volunteering at the local university hospital, in the pediatrics ward, and I passed out holding a baby that had yellow liquid coming out of its head and fell on the floor with the baby on my chest. I didn't hurt the baby, but a nurse came up and looked down at me while I was on the floor, and she said, maybe you shouldn't be a doctor. And I had been doing journalism since high school and publishing in college, and every time I'd publish something, I'd come alive and I'd be with journalists and feel like, these are my people. And every time I get with pre-med students who wanted to golf on Wednesdays, I just want to run for the hills. And so in 81, I had just finished and I got a job, a writing job, writing, not journalism, but doing slide tape training programs for the Chief of Naval Reserve about the minesweeping fleet. And I had long hair and I'd go out to sea with the military on minesweepers. And I then got a job writing computer-assisted instruction lessons for children with diabetes. And there was a gay man who worked there who told me about AIDS. And that was 1982, I think, or so, maybe 83 even. And that's how I really was introduced to the AIDS epidemic. And this was before HIV was even discovered.
Right. And you've written a ton about pathogens since then.
Yeah, well, it was part of my undergraduate major because the Salk Institute was right next door to UCSD. I wrote a long story about Jonas Salk with his cooperation, given the agreement that I would never publish it because he really didn't like media. And he was very interested, obviously, in polio vaccines and other vaccines. And that's what got me interested in vaccines. And in 1987, I was at the Free Weekly newspaper in Washington, D.C. And I did a story that resurrected my unpublished story and about Jonas Salk. And then in 89, I read a Washington Post story that said that he was collaborating on an AIDS vaccine with the guy at the NIH, which was right next to D.C. So I went to meet the guy and realized that, hey, there's a good story to do about the AIDS vaccine field. And that's how I really dove into becoming an HIV/AIDS reporter, because I sold a book contract based on that story that was supposed to be 1 year in the search for an AIDS vaccine and would that HIV behaved like SARS-CoV-2 and would be conquered by a vaccine, or at least in part in a year's time. The book was a ridiculous idea, but the book came out in 2001, 12 years after I wrote that City Paper article. I'm not advertising it. I don't expect this to lead to sales, but Shots in the Dark was the name of the City Paper story I did in 1989 about AIDS. So 12 years later, the book came out.
That's wild.
And I met David and I met in, we spoke in 1991 or 92, something like that.
Right. We spoke about the vaccine work that was being done by Robert Redfield, right?
That's right, yes.
I was doing a story on that fiasco.
Yeah.
I'm just showing a little bit. I have the sound off, but this is a little bit from your film from, I think it was 2012, showing one of the things that's consistent in both that film and this one is your focus on the social aspects of the vaccine race, or in the case of AIDS, just the treatment mm-hmm. issue as well. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about how that element seems to, you know, sometimes we don't focus enough on the social impediments or accelerants of progress along when something like this happens?
Well, you know, I guess because my motivation was always about, you know, getting the information for people, it's the people have been the primary focus of my science reporting. I also understand people a little better than I understand the science. And or at least I can make mistakes without getting caught too badly.
Yeah.
How to survive a plague is about the organizing that was done within the affected community, within the queer community, mostly people with HIV themselves, to try and do something to jumpstart research around ARVs, and also around the opportunistic infections that were claiming everybody's lives at the time. And I was interested, I covered all of that. I'm in so many of the frames of how to survive a a plague as a young reporter in the distance. It took me years to think about what had happened then, to understand how that activism really did work to catalyze and speed up a lot of that science work. So it really was an intersection of people and policy and science. It was always kind of the sweet spot of my interests.
One of the things that's disturbing about the current plague is, in some ways, it feels like the activism that has been dominant has been the impediment activism. Some extent, it's because there isn't a focal community at risk. Is that? I'll ask you both about that, David, and then John.
I would say that that's true. You know, when we first were sent home for lockdown, I thought, I'm going to find the activism that's going to be part of this solution. And I was surprised to not see any real effective activism on the part of kind of the citizen science movement that has become, you know, so kind of commonplace in organizing around illness. But the activism seemed to me at first to be coming from the scientists who were doing the work, who were, whose character really was forged in HIV, who had interacted with the AIDS activists themselves, because so many of them come from HIV. And so that it was very impressive to watch how battle ready they were. And then to watch the activism come out of left field, which I didn't expect, that kind of Trumpian hesitancy, let's call it, the anti-vax stuff that somehow was sparked by Trump himself. And I don't think anybody saw that happening. We set up to make sure that we were looking at hesitancy in the communities of people of color in the United States and around the world, marginalized communities where there's a traditional distrust of science. And then to watch it explode suddenly in the hands of kind of this very unexpected, you know, white, middle class, politically engaged population was very surprising.
Yeah, and the dynamics are still unfolding. To some extent, I think, maybe this is a hypothesis, I'm sure it's not testable, but you had the economic implications were so severe that was the plague, quote unquote, for many people, and that inflamed their activism. And, you know, you started to get, as John reported and everyone has reported, everyone started to know someone who got sick. But it was all, it didn't feel like it had that jarring, it didn't feel as jarring perhaps to most Americans, I guess. John, what do you think about all that?
Well, I think, you put your finger on the essential issue, which is that the community that was and is affected by HIV is, in many places, it's a marginalized community, and it's a limited number of people around the world, but this pandemic is everyone. And so there was no, the gay community that created the activism was an organized community before HIV showed up, fighting for rights and fighting laws that were discriminatory. So it grew out of something. This was everyone. And I think David put his finger on the other thing that's true to me, which is scientists have been the activists here. Right. And they were infected by AIDS activism. And they were trained by AIDS activism. And one of the things that David captures in How to Survive a Plague is how activists became incorporated by the scientific community. They were put on advisory boards. They argued their way into the world of science by doing astute analysis of both science and politics. And I think the scientists caught on for COVID, and as David noted, many of them were leading HIV/AIDS researchers, and they saw that you couldn't ignore science, you know, right. And scientists like to be antiseptic about this. Oh, don't blur the science with politics. It's utter bullshit. You know, science and politics go hand in hand, as this pandemic has powerfully demonstrated. And I think one of the things I like most about the film he made here is it shows the overlapping worlds of science and politics, and that you can't separate them in any country. It's not simply about Donald Trump versus the world of science. It's happening all over the place.
Do you have any feeling, you know, the Trump factor is so bizarre because the labeling, the branding of we're going to do this in a year, he owned, right? And then I guess he flipped into, as he saw this other signal emerging from his base, he flipped into supporting their doubts. Is there, what would an alternate film have looked like if Trump and or his staff had said, you know, let's stick with the salesman of this great solution? Would that have, is there a way to play that out?
I think he would have been reelected. I think if Trump had embraced the vaccine that he helped bring forward with warp speed and had made it his and had embraced the world of science and said, we're not going to rush anything through, we're going to do this properly. And when the vaccine started working, if he had been first in line to get vaccinated on television, I think it would have made a huge difference in the outcome of the election. I don't know what David thinks, but that's my take on it.
I think so too. I mean, there's clearly the chaos of the administration would still have been the same. And I think it was the one orderly thing that they did was the research through Warp Speed. I don't know that they had the wherewithal to do the kind of public health campaign that it would have taken to overcome those fears, and to make, to pull back the curtain on the vaccine development that would have allowed people to understand that it did take place within scientific only constructs, that this was not something that had been squeezed into a syringe to get out to people without the science or data to back it up. Mm-hmm. But I do think it is really the most and maybe single success of the Trump administration. And it was strange to watch him walk away from it.
Yeah, his own staff said that his greatest failure was not having empathy about the pandemic. That's what, you know, really undid his race for re-election.
Yeah, it's, but then for him, there were these overlapping simple messages about China, about, I don't know. It's so hard to play these what if games. At the same time, it feels useful to do it. What was the hardest part about just making the film, David? Obviously, there was another pandemic film that came out last year that was very focused on Trump, where they did something similar, distributing cameras and just getting, you know, you have this fairly seamless product, but can you give us a peek behind the curtain at what it took?
Yeah, that other film was Alex Gibney's Out of Control. He made the filmmaking contortions part of his story. Mm-hmm. And I had right from the start, I wanted to not be part of the telling of this. I really wanted to just give a platform for science and the scientists to let us see what they did, without congratulating myself for having been able to film some of it. But but we did go through those contortions, and we shot, you know, our first shoot day was even through windows. We didn't even go in inside the office to meet with people. We were lucky it was an office on the first floor, and I thought, after a while, we can't only just feature people who have first floor offices or laboratories. that wouldn't be doing us any good. So we spent some time developing robotic cameras. And I think I told you about this, John. We developed, we had like cameras in a box that we thought we could send over to people's house and they would have to set them up. And that seemed like too much to ask people like, you know, Kazmikia Corbett to assemble a camera package. And then we devised one that we could actually drive over the internet. It was kind of an iPad on a single swivel wheel. And we thought it could actually do the job. It would allow us into BSL-3 labs. And we took it out on a test drive. We went to IAVI in Brooklyn. They let us in. They were working on a vaccine there with Merck. Mm-hmm. And it was a colossal failure. Yeah, all the footage that we had was people looking in horror at this thing that was spinning around. And it kept running into the walls. And people kept running over to try to save it from running into walls. So we realized that if our goal was to get a vaccine out of all of this, we had to keep that robot out of a laboratory at all costs. So then we went to more kind of traditional remote stuff. John had a couple of cameras that we positioned around his office there in his home. And we did that with other people as well. And where possible, we also brought in a very small filming crew that we were able to communicate with and collaborate with over this complex online system of communications. We could speak into the ear of the person with the camera, and sometimes there was a sound person there at the same time. But we kept the footprint really low. We tried to hire really micro-local crews, mm-hmm. so we weren't putting people in airplanes if we could avoid it. And then we tried to make it seem like we didn't have to do all that stuff, that we were just making, right. just showing a film.
That's an interesting question that emerges in storytelling. There was just a conversation about this a couple of days ago on Twitter. Emma Maris, who's a very good long-form narrative writer about climate and other environmental issues, posed the question about stories where the reporter is in the story versus not. And when I was writing my first book in 1989 on the murder of Chico Mendez, because the reporting was so vivid and dramatic, being in the Amazon, you know, almost dying a couple of times, as a young journalist, I was really eager to throw that in. And my editor was absolutely, John Sterling was, no, this is Chico's story, not your story. And he was totally right. There was another book that came out that was all about the writer, mm-hmm. Alex Shumatov, who's a really good travel writer.
Of course.
I have no regrets, but it's hard. And John, you know, through this whole process as a journalist, you know, you've been mostly not able to be in places doing the stuff that historically you would have done. And in this film, you're a character. We know that you're a character in real life, but you definitely are helping drive the narrative. How difficult or interesting or weird was it to become kind of a public figure as opposed to someone asking questions and writing stories?
Well, part of the process of having cameras in my office didn't make me feel public. You know, I was just recording stuff that I was doing, and I wasn't performing for a camera. And as you can see in the film, I don't do my hair, I don't shave, I don't care what I look like at any moment. I only have vanity about one thing in the film, and that's my surfing. And mm-hmm. Dave was kind enough to use me on a decent wave on the right board, and I cared about that. We did go into the field. I mean, David had crews go with me to Cincinnati, Washington, D.C., Geneva, and India. And David and I went to India together during the surge there. And I've worked with documentary crews and television before. I did series with the PBS NewsHour in several countries. It's incredibly complicated to be a print reporter with cameras. It makes everything clumsier, and parts of me intensely dislike it. Because I do not want to walk down a hall a second time because an airplane went over and ruined the sound. And you have to do that when you're doing documentary film. And my wife also, she's made documentaries. I mean, she's a TV person. I understand the requirements, but I don't like it. And David knows that I bristle at stuff sometimes when I'm being kind of petulant, simply because as a print reporter, as you know, you're quiet, you're in the background, you can pretend to be invisible. You can never pretend to be invisible when you have a camera crew and sound people. It just makes it really hard to observe things from fly on the wall. But The thing that I like, and that what David did is he just uses what I was doing as kind of a narrative thread to tie together different stories. And it's not, as you were saying about your Amazon thing, it's not about me. It's about the topic, and I'm just a conduit into the ideas.
Right. So David, what were some of the most surprising moments you captured? My son and I, my son Jack, who you met, we were both struck by the Pennsylvania scenes with the preacher who was trying to build that trust in the community. It was really powerful. But there are also those great moments like Fauci with his glass of wine being completely candid. What were some of the things that you know, as this stuff was coming in or you were shooting that really...
I just was really surprised by those moments where where people really allowed us to know what it was like to be there at that time. Mm. I think certainly Peter Marks of the FDA was incredibly generous with an eye toward the value of this documentation for letting us know and letting the world know what went into the regulation and the mechanisms for establishing the trust in these vaccines, that he allowed us into that laundry room in his basement as often as he did was just really amazing. John is a great interviewer. He just pulled out some, and he's known so many of the folks in the film for so long that he was able to get a real candid and gentle series of interviews with people, and that was...
Although I would say not always gentle. There was some pretty... I remember some fun, oh, come on, moments.
That's the job.
This sparring with Adrian Hill of Oxford was really fun. It was how willing everybody was to really allow this time and this initiative to be chronicled was stunning. And then even people like Monsef Slaoui, after he left Operation Warp Speed, how open he was about saying what he had seen there and what he hoped to do there and what it was that he brought to that undertaking. Very human. It was very... that's the social side, I think, that I was so interested in. Like, these were like human beings doing this work, and, and I think that really helps demystify a little bit about what happened.
That scene in India, where it was the questions about distribution and the right to manufacture, was really interesting. John, how did that... John, that must have ended up in a story of yours. I just can't remember.
Yeah, I did a story all about the Serum Institute of India and it backing out of its contract with the organization set up to deliver vaccine to low and middle income countries, COVAX. So I did a full feature story about that. That's the thing about the whole process here. David was shooting me doing my job for science. And, you know, occasionally I would venture into terrain that was clear I couldn't use for science because it was too sensitive at that moment. And I would explain to people, look, you know, this is a time capsule. This is for the future. Right. I won't report this right now. But for the most part, I reported whatever I wanted out of the interviews I did. It was the exception to the rule where we separated out information for the film. And the India trip, David and I went there together, was, you know, really, when we planned it, we didn't know there was going to be a surge in India. And we didn't know that Serum Institute was going to stop exporting the vaccine, the COVAX. All of that developed in real time. And in fact, one of the crew, when we were at the Serum Institute, tested positive. You know, it was exploding all around us. And neither of us had ever seen that that level of... I mean, they were shutting down city after city in India when we were there.
Yeah,
it was a very dramatic visit. I wish the film had a half hour of the India trip. You know, I mean, that's one of the real frustrations with filmmaking for me, is David shot so much stuff that isn't there that's tremendous, you know, that a viewer doesn't know, but you know, we both know how much good material had to stay on the cutting room floor.
Mm-hmm. It's true. Well, yeah. We didn't know where the story was going to go, so we were just vacuuming the whole thing up as much as possible.
Right. When I taught a documentary production course at Pace University, one thing I always badgered the students about when we were in the field was shoot everything.
Yeah.
Every little thing. Shoot wide shots, shoot close shots, because you just don't know.
You discover your film in the footage.
That's so interesting.
You've got enough footage there to do it.
Film's an hour and 49 minutes. I imagine, I'm going to guess, David, you might know the answer. I imagine you have thousands of hours of footage.
I don't think it's probably multiple thousands, but but pretty close to 1,000 probably. I don't think we ever even added it up. We just kept filling drives with it and trying to find our story.
But Andrew, I had a revelation about the documentary the other morning after, you know, having watched it, because it's David's documentary. I didn't make it. I'm in it, but you know, he made it. And you know, I think documentaries largely take you into a world that you don't know exists, like David did Welcome to Chechnya, that takes you into Chechnya and the LGBT community there and smuggling people out, and emotionally involves you with the stories of strangers, people you don't know, and takes you through their path in this world. Or documentaries look back, like he did with How to Survive a Plague, to try to understand the past. What happened there? How did it happen? And you go on the emotional journey of people who went through life and death often in the past. But this film takes us on a journey through a place that we all know and takes you back behind the scenes to show you things that you don't know, I hope. But also the emotional journey is personal because we all went through this. And it reminds us of so many things that, you know, traumatic that we all experienced. And I think that's its unusual emotional power, is that it's a very personal experience.
So I want to get back to the present here before we close out. And it's a Friday and everyone's got things to do. And we have to survive not just the pandemic, but all the ramifications of what's going on with Vladimir Putin and so much more on this planet. Appreciate your time. But just one thing that's touched on in the film, and that could be a sequel, is the race for the sort of pan vaccine. I think it's in there. You know, what is the frontier now? This maybe John first on this question of
I'm
thinking ahead.
I'm writing a book about how science can thwart the next pandemic. So I follow that field very closely. I think it's entirely possible we can make a vaccine that works against all SARS-CoV-2 variants and even all SARS-related coronaviruses. There's building evidence that that's really, really doable. This family of viruses is not difficult to stop with vaccines. Is there the momentum that existed? No. You know, there is no warp speed to make that happen. And it will plod along the way we always plod along with vaccines, because we as humans are really bad at prevention. We have a law that requires us to wear seatbelts because we're so foolish that we don't even want to wear seatbelts, you know. And I think that's the real dilemma of our times, is did we learn from this? And I think the answer is kind of, sort of, maybe, not really.
Yeah, actually, I should ask you, I remember this Walter Reed research on a sort of a potential uniform vaccine, maybe 3 months ago, there was this bubble of
news. Yeah, it's moving forward, it's one of the candidates.
Yeah.
But the problem is it takes a whole lot of money and a whole lot of resources to stage efficacy trials of any vaccine. And Warp Speed had $12 billion to do that. And in addition, you had Pfizer saying, we'll pay for it itself. We don't even want. And you had the Chinese government, which, as the film explains, had its own kind of Warp Speed effort with billions of dollars. That doesn't exist now because we are terrible at prevention. I'm sorry to say that about us, but we're just,
believe me.
Well, look at how many people don't want to get vaccinated. But, you know, I'm sorry. I don't, at the end of the day, have a good explanation for why people who don't have some unusual circumstance would not avail themselves of something that clearly is safer than the virus itself. It's perplexing, but that's humans. That's who we are.
Sure seems to be. So David, now that you've done these two films on viruses and their consequences, it sounds like you're done with that arena for a while. Are you already well into your next project?
I am not, but I would love to stay away from pandemics for a couple of years, as I know we all would. Although I joke about it, all of my films to date have been about kind of mass death experiences. And I would like, you know, just once to do a comedy.
Yeah. I wouldn't say the funny, the funny thing about Don't Look Up, which I wrote several pieces about, the Adam McKay's film, he insisted it was about climate. And I insisted, no, it's about what John just articulated. It's about human nature. It doesn't matter the comet, whether it's a virus, a comet, the broader question of climate change. It's definitely not specific to one of these issues. It is a hole in our capacities to a certain extent, feels like. And I don't know how you make a film about that, but it's something we have to think about. I'm showing from Twitter, I created this little graphic because I've written about this, you know, in the context of earthquake risk, pandemics a little bit, climate and other factors for decades. Disaster amnesia is a thing. If you go into Google Scholar, you search for the phrase disaster amnesia, it's a thing. And this is what you're looking at there is great earthquakes. It just happens that between 1964 and 2004, there was this really big gap in big, bad earthquakes. And the ones that happened closest to that time were fairly remote places. So, and what did we do between 1964 and 2004? We built the modern world, all these giant cities all through the Himalayas. And so when the next ones come, you know, it's like, shouldn't be a surprise to anyone. It's just this same phenomenon. And I do wonder how we go forward. But I'll tell you, I'm really glad that both of you are doing what you've done to help fill the gaps. I'm sorry, Laurie Garrett couldn't join. She's one of the busiest people I know, not just a journalist, but she's focused on, you know, the policy questions as well. And hopefully John will resume some of our Friday sessions with Laurie and Bob Bazell and Wendy someday. Thank you, John Cohen from Science Magazine and from this film for being on today. And David France, the filmmaker behind How to Survive a Pandemic and How to Survive a Plague. It's a pleasure to talk with you both today. And for Thank those you. Who are watching, you can share the videos on whatever platform you have watched on. They become archived right away on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn. Go forward into the weekend. Wake up every day.
HBO Max.
Right.
And see How to Survive a Pandemic there. Or ifcfilms.com. You can find, or I think YouTube, many of the other platforms you can find How to Survive a Pandemic.
Right. And the hashtag is out there, How to Survive a Pandemic on Twitter. You can find lots more just by Googling that phrase. And davidfrance.com has some interesting information on the plague film from the AIDS, the peak of the AIDS years. So thanks again for being here. This is Andy Revkin, of Columbia Climate School, Columbia University, Sustain What, Where Consequence and Complexity Collide. That's where these conversations happen. And let's just move the ball forward a little bit each time. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Andy.
Take care.